Jimmy.
Every July, the fittest athletes in the world are united by a shared desire, the relentless pursuit of the ultimate individual goal.
Are you kidding me?
Oh my goodness.
Can't this guy do? The dream is becoming reality. Seconds, no more. Matt Fraser is the fittest man on earth.
That all changes today as former adversaries compete as allies.
Impressive. We were not expecting to see that at all.
177, and that's a PR. And the Europe team will take the first heat.
Here, territorial pride turns rivals into teammates, united in another relentless pursuit.
And the Americans will lock up 6 points
to win the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational.
Sixteen of the best CrossFit athletes in the world divided into four teams vying for international bragging rights. Welcome to the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada. The Invitational has always been an international affair, but the U.S. has dominated. They have won 3 of 4, and both in this current four-team format. Thank you for joining us, everybody. I'm Sean Woodland with Chase Ingram. Even though the United States has won the last two, Canada has been close, and today they have home field advantage.
Close, they've been very close. Second 2 years in a row, but with the home crowd, this could be what they need to finally topple the United States.
The final event the last 2 years, that has been a little mistake or a big disaster that has kept Canada from the top of the podium.
2014, disaster. They blew it. They got last in that event, fell out. USA jumped ahead. I think Paul Tremblay was unfairly, you know, blamed for that, not being able to climb the rope, but he had to do so much work on those tire flips because the girls just couldn't handle the weight. 2015, however, they had a shot. They were down going into the final event, but they just couldn't recover. The USA came back and beat them bad in the event before, and I don't think they ever recovered from that.
The history is there, but the roster is not. Three new faces this year for the Canada team, and they are led by two very talented male rookies in Brent Fikowski and Patrick Vellner.
I would say two stud male rookies. Third place in the games, Vellner. Fourth place, Fikowski, just 2 points behind them. These are the best male athletes they've ever had at the Invitational, and this is going to bode well for them to get up in that first place position today.
The United States comes in as the defending champions, but they also have some new faces as well.
For the second year in a row, they have two rookie girls for the United States with Carrie Pierce and Brooke Wells. Pierce, a little sick a couple days leading into this, so there's some question marks there, But there's no question that she deserves to be here. Phenomenal gymnastics and the endurance to topple Murph. So she definitely has that in her repertoire. Brooke Wells, one of the strongest females in CrossFit, but she has some major holds with high-skilled gymnastics, which we'll see in that final event.
But they have some veteran skill backing them up. The two men, Rich Froning and Ben Smith. If there was a Mount Rushmore of CrossFit, these two guys are on it. Rich Froning, the four-time individual champion, has also won the affiliate cup the last 2 years of the games. Six straight gold medals for him. Ben Smith, eight appearances at the CrossFit Games and the 2015 Fittest Man on Earth. Rich Froning for the second straight year, an athlete and a coach, and he's standing by with Rory McKernan.
What did you tell them to get ready for an event like this?
There's not much to tell them. They know what they need to do. They're not rookies when it comes to competing in CrossFit, so they'll be just fine.
In the games with CrossFit Mayhem Freedom, you were in an event very similar to this. What's the key to victory in a synchronized deadlift workout?
I think just smooth as fast and make sure everybody's kind of on the same page on everything. So,
all right, good luck, Rich. Thank you.
Thank you, Ro. Seven total events here in the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational, and we kick it off where all four team members will be working at the same time. Event one, 21:15.9 of deadlifts at 854 pounds, and then bar-facing burpees.
Well, this is the third iteration we've seen of this particular event. Regionals, we had two. Games, we had three. We've added a fourth athlete to this bar. I don't know how many more you can squeeze in there, but they're going to try it today.
Rory McKernan is on the competition floor with more on the keys to event number one.
Yeah, Sean, check this thing out. It's impossible to miss. This axle bar is fat, and it's 86 pounds on its own. It looks more like a cartoon than an implement of fitness. Then you put seven big wheels on each side, 850 pounds between the four athletes. So, of course, the deadlift portion is going to be extremely important. But also bear in mind, there are 17 transitions through the course of this workout. So that's 17 opportunities for athletes to get out of sync if they're not communicating well or acting as a team.
Thank you, Ro. Chase, you've been part of a lot of team competitions in the past, and you know that even though those transitions are quick and they seem like small little details, they can make a huge difference.
A huge difference. Just say you lose 1 second every transition. You lost 17 seconds. Where are you going to make that up? On the deadlifts or on the burpees? Now double that if you have one hiccup. So the transitions are going to be huge in this particular event.
The Canada team getting ready to attack the deadlift bar, as is the Europe team. Three of its members from Iceland. Lucas Hogberg, the only man from Sweden on that team. The 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational is underway. We kick it off with those 21 deadlifts. And where you arrange your athletes here, Chase, is key. The men on the outside for every team here.
Absolutely. You put the guys on the outside, your strongest lifters who have the immediate impact on the load.
At the top of your screen, the team that is currently leading will be highlighted in blue. The number next to them in the white box will either indicate how many reps they have completed or how many reps behind they are of the leader. Right now, it's Pacific, the United States, and Europe out front early. They have to advance that bar every 7 reps on this initial set of 21.
And you're looking at the leaderboard or the athletes coming in. United States was a heavy favorite just because of two back-to-back wins. But Pacific on the left side is the team that can topple the United States alongside with Canada. But they need to make the most out of what they can. This is an event that the Pacific can steal from the United States.
All four teams are on to those bar-facing burpees. They have to be synchronized. That means that their chests have to be on the ground at the same time, and they have to jump over the bar with a 2-foot takeoff at the same time.
Canada was struggling a lot in the synchronization on the barbell, and we saw that in practice. At the time in practice, Vellner was counting out the reps, but the problem is when you're with a team and you're saying go, you can't do it from an individual standpoint. When you're an individual and I say go, I'm going when I'm saying go. If you pull early and not wait for your team, there can be some miscommunication, and that's what got Canada behind after the first round of 21.
The Pacific team is the first onto their last set of 7 deadlifts here on this initial round of 21. Then they'll advance the barbell one more time, and they will start their set of 15. Rory McKernan, the Pacific team looking pretty good here early on.
backstage and throughout the entire week, it was very clear the Pacific team is more like family than a team. Notice they're not even necessarily communicating verbally. Their coach, Chad McKay, said, in fact, they're going to just feel each other out, and they're doing a fantastic job of it so far. Whereas the U.S. team backstage, they were doing their own thing, warming up almost as individuals. So watch the Pacific. This could be their year for that reason.
Pacific team on the left of your screen, they are still in the lead. They're through 50 of the total 90 reps in this event. The United States, four behind them, Europe, and then Canada.
But for the second section in a row, these sets of five, the Pacific has had to drop the bar in the middle of the set due to miscommunication. And what does Rich do best? What do his teams do best? They charge late at the end. They find a rhythm in the beginning through the sevens. They continue that through the fives, wait for the set of threes, and that's when you'll see the U.S. make their push, but the Pacific has to get ahead of them.
Those are your two leaders. The Pacific team is on the left. The United States is on the right. Pacific now through 60 of their 90 total reps, and they are holding a very narrow lead over Rich Froning and the Americans. Remember, Ben Smith, who is on the left of your screen, he's the 2015 fittest man on earth. He's been bothered by a back problem. I talked to him during practice earlier in the week. He said right now he feels fine, but there are some things that aggravate it, and handstand walking is one of them. But right now, Ben Smith is looking pretty good, Ro.
Let's watch him on these burpees. That wouldn't be the issue, as we know. When he gets back to that deadlift bar, we're going to know. When I got to Ben before the event, he told me, you can talk about the back, but it's an absolute non-issue. At the moment, it looks as if that might not have been true. And remember, later on, we have a heavy one-rep max clean and, or snatch from Ben. So we'll have to see what happens here and how that shakes out.
The United States in second place. The Pacific team threw 72 of their 90 total reps. They are on their set of nine deadlifts and then nine bar-facing burpees. And they're trying to kick off the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational with an event win. 6 points to the winner, four for second place, two for third, and none for fourth. And right now, it's the Canada team in front of their home crowd who sits in fourth place. But the Pacific team continues to lead the United States by a handful of repetitions.
Pacific is moving well ahead of them, but Ben Smith is not right. None of those burpees. He was late on every one on the down. Couldn't push the, yes, look, he has to push it from the side. He's out of it. There's something wrong with Ben Smith right now.
Smith and his teammates are back on the barbell. And remember, height plays a difference here. Because when you have athletes of different height, it's going to affect your pull. That could be something that is adversely affecting Ben Smith.
Here's what the United States needs to look out for. Europe on the yellow lane has moved up ahead of them because Ben is lagging behind. So Pacific needed a win and a little bit of help. And they're going to get it from Europe if the U.S. can't keep pace.
And the Pacific team, 6 points to kick off the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational as they take events number one. Now the battle for second. 4 points on the line, and it's going to go to Europe. And it looks like if the United States can keep this pace, they will finish in third. They do. So Canada, in the opening event, will get blanked on the scoreboard. This crowd in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada, here at the Tribute Community Center, cheering their team on to get them across the finish line. It's just a formality now as they are just wanting to finish. They won't earn any points heading into the second event, so Canada putting themselves in an early hole here.
We talked about the communication coming in, and we weren't sure if it was going to be there, and that was a bad start for Canada.
Canada is in, but it's Carl Webb and the Pacific team who win the event, and they will have the early lead with six events remaining here on the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. Tia Toomey leaving the floor as she and Carl Webb will take center stage for the Pacific team in the next two events. And now Rob Forte and James Newberry heading back.
Europe, a late charge towards the end because of that apparent, I don't know, I'm not going to go stretch to say injury to Ben Smith, but U.S. really needs to be worried about that. At the start, the Pacific so strong. Like you said before, they've worked well throughout all of these practices. Not a surprise to see them do so well here in this event. And when we're looking at points on the board, they needed to steal a couple of events from the United States, but even more so, have a team like Europe sneak up in between. So with those 6 points to kick things off, that's a great start for the Pacific team.
The Pacific team, 508.12 seconds. They get the win. Europe 10 seconds behind them. The United States comes in 524, and it's Canada in fourth place. And Rory McKernan is with the Pacific team.
James, it's your first Invitational. You got one out of the way. How is this different from being at the CrossFit Games?
Oh, it's such a cool experience with a massive crowd so close to you this time. The team worked so well. We held it together. Did exactly what we needed to do. It was good fun.
Rob, you guys obviously did a fantastic job, but some things went wrong. Tell people what they might not have seen during the event.
Well, the bar ended up on James's feet. I think the bar slipped out of somebody's hands and ended up on the ground and bounced across. But you just got to keep going, not let that stuff faze you, and I think we did a pretty good job of that.
I'd say so. Congratulations.
Thank you.
James Newberry and Rob Forte helping their team to an early victory in event one, and they have a 2-point lead as we head into event number two, and they will sit and watch as Carl Webb and Tia Claire Toomey look to build on that. Canada needs to score some points, but it's the Pacific team that has the lead. Event number two is up next from the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. The 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational on ESPN is brought to you by Reebok, the exclusive outfitter of CrossFit and the CrossFit Invitational. Time to lift big. Event two up next as the Pacific team has a 2-point lead over Europe after event number one. One rep max snatch and a one rep max clean and jerk. One woman will snatch, one woman will clean and jerk. The team score is the sum of the max snatch plus the max clean and jerk. Here are your lifters for the snatch. Carl Webb for the Pacific team. Carrie Pierce, the United States, the defending fittest woman on earth. Catherine David's daughter for Europe. And Michelle O'Donnell. Now, this is earlier. Carl Webb during practice PRing her snatch. And she is up first and cannot hit 200 pounds. She will get one more attempt. She does have a 30-second window, so she can go again if she can set up quickly, and she's going to make another run at it. And that won't happen for Carl Webb.
Now, the same thing happened to her in 2014 where she missed her opening lift. So we said she PR'd twice in the warm-up area. It's a big difference when you only got two lifts.
Kari Pierce up next, 170 pounds, and that'll count. So United States on the board, thanks to Kari Pierce. And she can make another attempt, too, because she has a 30-second window. So now adding to her total, won't be able to hit that. So 170 pounds, though, still good for Kari Pierce and the Americans. Catherine Davis, daughter of the Europe team, will be up next.
Now, Kara's sole job in the United States is to keep it close for Brooke Wells, who's super strong on the clean and jerk.
190 pounds on the bar for Catherine Davis, daughter. And that is picture perfect for the two-time fittest woman on earth. 190 pounds for the Europe team, and she's being congratulated by Samantha Briggs, the Europe coach, and now Michelle O'Donnell, as the Canadians feeling some early pressure here after failing to score any points in the first event. And the six-time games veteran hits that. 187 is good, and now adding to her total once again. And LaTundra back-to-back.
What I love most about this event, it's about strength, but also strategy. All these athletes came out with a two-lift combo in mind, knowing you do have 30 seconds to hit two lifts. Not a whole lot.
Carl Webb needs to get on the board for Australia, for the Pacific team. She steps off the mat, so I don't know if that's going to count. That is a no rep for Carl Webb.
Now,
I don't know if she realizes that.
I don't know if she realizes that she only has two lifts total to do. Oh, okay.
That was a practice lift for Carl Webb. So Carl Webb with a practice lift. That did not count. So Webb getting one attempt in, and she was able to stand it up, but they have to stay on that black mat. Their feet have to be entirely on the black mat. But Michelle O'Donnell, with the pressure on here early for Team Canada, hits not one, but two back-to-back lifts, and they look extremely good.
Well, not to say it's a must-have, but when you get a zero in the first event and you're the home team, you got to put something big to get some momentum back going into the middle team event.
And Carl Webber's second attempt, and Carl Webb will get on the board for Australia, and she's going to make one more attempt. Chad McKay, her coach, helping her load the bar. So 200 is already in the books for the Pacific team, and they have the lead. No good for Carl Webb, but 200 pounds, a very solid score for the Pacific squad. Now Carrie Pierce with a 180-pound attempt. That is good for Carrie Pierce. Rich Froning adding more weight on the bar. Carrie Pierce with another attempt. Can't quite stand it up, but Carrie Pierce, all she really needs to do is keep it close because Brooke Wells is very strong. I think mission accomplished for her.
Keep it close, but 20 pounds, it's a big difference.
Catherine David's daughter at 202, and this is where the teams that lift later have an advantage because they know what they need to hit in order to put their teams in the lead or at least within striking distance. So 202, the first attempt for Catherine David's daughter, will not go. Attempt number two. And Catherine David's daughter jumping ahead of Carl Webb, so Europe has the lead now.
And if I'm not mistaken, she's been chasing 200 for the last couple of years. That might have been a 2-pound PR.
Now Michelle O'Donnell, 198. And Michelle O'Donnell, 3 for 3. And now she and Camila Blanc-Bazinet adding more weight to the bar.
Now you can't have the same effort. You have to pull it even higher on the second attempt.
Just didn't have anything left, but Michelle Otter, great effort for her as we have a very close race. As we will hand it off to the second set of women as they will now go for a one rep max clean and jerk. Europe the lead at 202. Pacific right behind them. And then it's Canada and the United States in fourth place. But remember, Brooke Wells needs to be one of the favorites in this next lift. And that's a look at Carl Webb and her make it 200 pounds. And that was a big lift for her as the pressure was on. And now Kari Pierce, her best lift at 180 pounds. Finally, Catherine David's daughter at 202.
That was a hell of a save by David's daughter.
And her second attempt at it as well. Catherine David's daughter helping out her team, and Michelle Atondra keeping Canada in the hunt as well. They need to get some points here in event number two. The men will be doing this same combination of lifts, but later on in the competition. Michelle Atondra's second attempt is no good, but gets a great salute from the crowd here. Europe with a 2-pound advantage over the Pacific as we head into the clean and jerk. Canada is right there as well. In the United States, Brooke Wells is going to have a big performance for them if they are going to win event number two. 3 points for the winner in this event, 2 for second place, 1 for third, and none for fourth place.
The United States is a little bit on their heels right now, getting a third place finish in event one. You know, Kari Pierce, we knew she wasn't going to have the best snatch. We needed her to keep it close. The U.S. needed her to keep it close with Brooke Wells having the highest clean and jerk coming in. But look at who she's going against. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Tia Tarakumi, who went to the Olympics for this event. So she has a tall order ahead of her if she wants to get USA any points out of this second event.
Tia Tumi composing herself. Same rules apply here as they did for the max snatch. Two attempts and a 30-second window in which to do them. Brooke Wells for the United States. That's Sarah Sigmund's daughter representing the Europe team. Carol Ann Reason Tebow. Now, Tia Claire Tumi.
I'm curious to see what Carol Ann's going to bring to this team. We're not really sure of what, you know, her strengths and weaknesses are. How is she going to mesh with the group of three? This is her time to shine and to really, you know, take that step forward in the limelight to see what she can bring to this Canada team.
Brooke Wells will be the first woman to lift. Sarah Sigmund's daughter will be second. Carol Ann Reason Tebow will be third. And now Tia Tumi will be fourth. Brooke Wells finishing in sixth place with 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. Remember, she won the deadlift ladder. The second event at the games this year, when she deadlifted 420 pounds. First attempt for Brooke Wells, and that was no problem whatsoever. 232 pounds in the books for her. And Wells will not make another attempt in this 30-second window, and we'll hand things off to the woman who has finished third in back-to-back years at the CrossFit Games, Sarah Sigmund's daughter. Sigmund's on her under that. Now she's got to get it overhead. No problem for Sarah Sigmund's daughter at 240 pounds. And now Europe with a 30-pound advantage over the United States with one lift remaining for those two teams. Carol Ann Reason Tebow with her first attempt. And Michelle Atondra getting this Canadian crowd behind Carol Ann Reason Tebow. That lift will count for Carol Ann Reason Tebow at 222 pounds. And she may be making another attempt, but they're not. They're just loading the bar, and Carol Ann Reason Tebow is going to rest. The weights that you see in the top of the screen in the white box are the combined totals. So Tia Tumi will close out round one for the Pacific team. Tia Tumi hits that. 235 pounds for Tia Toomey. The Pacific moves within 7 pounds of Europe. 247 on the bar for Brooke Wells as she kicks off round two, her second and final lift. Let's take a look back at everyone's first attempt. It was Brooke Wells kicking it off at 232 pounds, and all of these women made that initial lift look pretty easy.
The thing with Sarah is that clean nearly crushed her underneath, but overhead, so strong in that position. So for Sigmund's daughter, you know, just 7 pounds behind the total for Pacific, she's going to need that hit that clean a little bit better if they want to jump up in that first place spot. Now to Bo, Brooke, now here's the unfortunate part for the United States. She's going first, so she can't play the game of how much weight do I need to at least get some points on the board. They're not going to touch Europe or Pacific. They're over 30 pounds behind, but she can set up a pound weight right here to at least get some points on the board ahead of Canada.
3 points for the winner of this event, 2 for second, 1 for third, and none for fourth. Brooke Wells trying to get her team some points here. She will stand that up. And that will count for Brooke Wells. 247 pounds, and the United States will have the lead at least for one more lift, as now Sarah Sigmund's daughter will make a run at 250. Struggles with it, but now Sarah Sigmund's daughter is in a position to earn 3 points for her team. And can't hold it overhead. So Europe will be settling with 442 pounds. Great effort by Sigmund's daughter.
Now Tabo has to have at least 230 on the bar.
And that'll count for Carol Ann Ruiz-Atibo. And now they're going to try to make one more run as LeBlanc-Vazernay and LaTondra rush in to add a little more weight. Every pound is going to count here. And Thibault can't get herself out of the hole, but Canada now sits in second place with a combined score of 430 pounds. Make that third place behind Pacific. Now Tia Toomey will hit her final lift. And Pacific, just won event number two. So they have gone back to back here, and a great start for them as they will take event two with a combined total of 447, 5 pounds heavier than Europe. Here's Brooke Wells with her second attempt.
And that's knocking on the door, the most weight she's ever put up overhead. And there's really not much you can do on her side. We really needed to see more from Pierce, whereas Sigmund's daughter, that short step out in front, not able to step through, get underneath the bar. And a lot of times that happens from a really tough clean. But Tabo did exactly what she needed to do to get points on the board for Canada. She only needed 10 pounds. She only needed 8 pounds more than she previously did. Nailed it, got Canada a point.
Canada picks up a single point. But here's your winner, Tia Toomey. The advantage of going last was able to leapfrog Europe by a total of 5 pounds. And guess who finishes in fourth and will not earn any points? That's the United States. So the Pacific is off to a great start here through two events. 5 events remain, though. But right now, they are looking good. And Rory McKernan is with Carl Webb and Tia Toomey.
Kara, things went a little bit different out here than they did backstage. Tell me about that.
Well, backstage, I was nice and fresh. I got a lifetime PB of the 100 kilos or 220 pounds in my nanos. Yeah.
So it didn't come together out here, but you're still pretty excited.
Yeah, I was like, someone tell my coach, I got it. But anyway, I went so ham on the workout out here for my team, and then it didn't come together the way I wanted out here, but just tried to be strong and pull it together as best I could, and luckily I had Tia to lean on in that one, and we came together.
Indeed. And Tia, you got to lift this year for your country in the Olympics. How did this experience differ from that?
Oh, that's a hard question. Yeah, this is definitely awesome with all you guys here, so thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Tia Toomey and Carl Webb make it 2 for 2 for the Pacific team. The teams are back out in their entirety on the floor when we return. Event 3 is up next. The Pacific team looking to go 3 for 3. After two events, it's the Pacific. Perfect so far, 9 total points with a 3-point lead over the Europe team. The United States and Canada putting themselves in an early hole. The women still on the floor for the handstand walk relay. It's a relay style handstand walk with each athlete walking the length of the floor one time. We did something like this at the games this year, much longer distance, and it was Catherine Davis' daughter who finished in first, but Carrie Pierce and Brooke Wells. Their team needs a win. They could possibly get one here. Catherine Davis on the light blue. She's in the yellow lane. She'll kick things off for the Europe team. Already, Michelle Letondra is kicked down, and we had a false start.
Well, that was exciting. Kind of holding our collective breaths here, but Catherine leading out the charge for the European team. She is quote-unquote the best handstand walker for CrossFit. But the deal is that Carrie Pierce, who's going second for United States, of 280 feet at the CrossFit Games, lost by 0.2 tenths of a second.
Catherine Davis' daughter will be the first woman out for the Europe team. Sarah Sipping's daughter awaits
at the other end. And this is a strength for Katherine Davis' daughter. Sarah Sigmund's daughter, not so much. She can do it, but the question is how quickly can she accomplish this, hoping that Davis' daughter can get her a lead.
Can you do it? And can you do it fast? And Carrie, who's going second, anchoring for the United States. Now, Brooke Wells is no slouch either, because she got third at the CrossFit Games. So you have your second and third best, quote-unquote, handstand walkers in the CrossFit community at the moment on the floor.
That start will count. 3 points to the winner of this event, two for second, one for third, and none for fourth place. And it's Katherine Davis' daughter and Brooke Wells out front early. Davis' daughter's in the yellow lane. Brooke Wells is in the blue, and Davis' daughter has about a 1 foot lead on Brooke Wells. And Tia Toomey, meanwhile, is struggling. She is way back in fourth place. Michelle Latonda from Canada sits in third.
Here's the trick as you get to the mats. It's 15 feet. They have to go unbroken, and Brooke Wells kicks off to Carrie Pierce. So this is exactly what the United States needed. Sitting in third place with just 2 points, but not just trying to get a win here, but get a win on Pacific as she passes Tia Terakumi. They have to get a zero. The United States needs 3 points.
And the United States well on their way towards 3 points as Brooke Wells and Katherine Davis out made the tag at about the same time, but Carrie Pierce has opened up a gigantic lead on Sarah Sigmund's daughter, and the United States will earn its first event win in the handstand walk relay. 3 points to the Americans.
Now that's great. She did exactly what needed to do. 3 points. Europe is going to get two, but the race that's important for the United States, if they want to stay in it, is between Canada and the Pacific.
Sarah Sigmund's daughter is across. Second place and 2 points for the Europe team. And now the battle for third. As it's Michelle Hunt, I'm sorry, Carol Ann Reese and Thibault coming across the finish line for Canada. They will get 1 point. And now, for the first time, the Australians, the Pacific team, will fail to earn a point in an event.
But if you're looking at the stats coming in, this is definitely one of those statistics that matter. How good are you at this singular movement? And we knew the Pacific team was going to have trouble with this.
There are your winners. Carrie Pierce and Brooke Wells take it for the United States. Tia Toomey, who won the last event for her team, struggled early on that handstand.
Well, she came down early and she came down often. And we know she had some trouble at the games there. Sarah as well, getting 18th at the CrossFit Games. Just consistent but not fast. And that, you know, when you have someone like Carrie Pierce and Katrin Davis on her side to side, they're going to make you look slow, but she still did really well. But Carrie Pierce, this is where she needed to make up. This is why she's on the team. It wasn't for the snatch event, it was for gymnastics.
The United States earns its first event win. They beat Europe by nearly 20 seconds. Canada comes in at a minute 32.68, and then the Pacific team at 148.87 seconds. The United States trying to build some momentum as Carrie Pierce leads them to victory in event three. Event four is up next when the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational continues.
The 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational on ESPN is brought to you by Rogue Fitness, the official equipment supplier for the CrossFit Invitational.
Teams back out on the floor in their entirety. Event number four as Pacific brings a one-point lead over Europe. The United States, courtesy of that win in event number three, is creeping closer. Canada remains in fourth place with 2 points. Event number four, full team, synchronized bar muscle-ups. The reps on those go down as we progress through the event, and then pig flips. Also, the reps on those decrease as we move through the event. That's an implement that was first introduced at the 2015 Reebok CrossFit Games, and Rory McKernan has more on the pig.
The director of the CrossFit Games, Dave Castro, told me for most teams, this workout will be about the synchronized bar muscle-ups, but my eyes will be on the pig in the lane for the U.S. men. Ben Smith has owned this implement at the CrossFit Games, but as we now know, his back is not 100%, so watching him on this implement should be indicative of the U.S.'s chances to come back.
And what I'm curious to see is that we had two questions about the United States coming, or one question coming into this event. How is Brooke Wells going to do with the gymnastics? Now we have two. Can Ben Smith even flip that pig? Because he could barely even roll the bar forward in event number one. Now with the USA within striking distance, a big finish here can put him back in contention.
Event four has begun, and we start with 15 synchronized bar muscle-ups. The athletes all need to be locked out on top of the bar at the same time in order for the rep to count.
Now,
each rep will count for one at the top of your screen, so there'll be 15 total count. A little weird scoring things here that we want to get to as we go through the event. We'll explain those so you know exactly how much work remains. Just know 48 total reps on the scoreboard in this event.
15 reps is that secret number. Close enough where you think you can get it. It's close to people's maxes, but you don't need to go unbroken here. What you need to make sure is when you break is that it was your choice, not that you went too far. Because once that pull-up bar starts making decisions for you, you're in a black hole and it's hard to get out of.
The United States getting set to close out their first set of 15, and they will now move on to the assault bikes and the rowers, the Pacific team and Canada right there with them. The athlete on the rower, the male athlete on the rower, needs to complete 24 calories. The male athlete on the bike needs to complete 20. The female athlete on the rower needs to complete 20 calories. The female athlete on the bike needs to complete 16.
Now in practice, I saw Ben Smith on the rower and Rich on the bike because Rich can handle that work capacity just a little bit more than Ben. But this is where it pays off to have communication between your athletes and your coach as an athlete, to putting Ben on the bike to save his back for the pig.
One total rep will be added to the team score at the top of your screen when all four of them complete the work that they need to do on those machines. They cannot move on to the pigs until all four of them are done.
Now these machines in the middle are just designed to make this workout suck just a little bit more, especially when you get to these pigs. We've seen some athletes have trouble with this in practice, and that's not after this cows.
And the Pacific team is waiting on Tia Tooley. She is done. The United States onto the pigs as well. And Ben Smith, that thing weighs 550 pounds for the men, no problem. Four total flips for each pair. 550 for the men, 360 pounds for the women. After they complete four flips each, or as a pair, they will return for a set of 12 synchronized bar muscle-ups.
Great news for the United States. Ben, two flips. Now, what the United States should do going into the second round is that it's three pig flips. Rich needs to take the load for Ben on that one.
They have to alternate, so Rich will take two. Ben would take one. The United States first team, back to the pull-up bar. They will now do 12 synchronized bar muscle-ups as Canada is running into a huge problem on that pig as Carol Ann Reason Tebow is having trouble flipping that thing. So Canada, they are in an early hole, and they have got to start scoring some points here to move up the leaderboard. This crowd trying to get behind Carol Ann Reason Tebow, who is continuing to struggle with that. And Canada is in danger of maybe being out of contention here. 6 points goes to the winner of this event, 4-2, 2-3, and none to fourth. And it's the Pacific team and the United States who are currently fighting for the top spot with the European team right behind them.
I like the structured break for the United States, giving Brooke Wells just a little bit extra rest. Now, we got lucky with the bar muscle-ups because it's a lot easier to hold the top of that position to stay in synchronization. But the United States has to win this event if they want to stay in contention for their third repeat for that first place.
Meanwhile, on the bottom left of your screen, Carol Ann Rees and Tebow in Canada is well behind as they have just closed out their four pig flips. The United States is your leader. Remember, on the scoreboard, the number they need to hit is 48. They'll receive one more rep again after the four of them exit those machines and move on for three pig flips each pair.
Interesting to see is that Rich and Ben did flip-flop for the second round as Ben on the right side is on the rower where Rich is on the assault bike.
This is where we stood coming into this event. The United States in third place. Pacific with the lead after winning two of the first three events. The Europeans sit in second place. Canada in fourth with two. The United States can earn 6 points with an event win here. And then the question is, by how much can they beat the Pacific team?
Well, that's when you're looking from left to right. On your left is Europe. If you're the United States and you have the ability to take this event, you need Europe to get ahead of the Pacifics. But the Pacific is pushing hard, trying to keep pace with the United States. They're over on the left side. If it were to work out in this order right now, Pacific would still hold a 2-point lead on the United States.
The men will do the max snatch and clean and jerk immediately following this event, so the women get a break, so they can really sell out here because they're going to have some rest time to recover for the seventh and final event. This is the fourth of seven events here at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational, and Rich Froning takes that first pig flip. At 550 pounds, Ben Smith will take just one, and Froning will close out that set of three as the United States is moving ahead of the Pacific team.
Pacific has about 5 seconds on Europe. Europe over on the right side.
U.S. is done. 9 synchronized bar muscle-ups. Same amount of calories on the bike and rower, and then 2 final pig flips. Pacific staying on the United States' heels, and they have yet to complete a rep. At the top of your screen, the United States leaders are in a blue box. The number they need to hit is 48 reps on that scoreboard. Send it down to Rory McCurtin, the third member of our broadcast team.
Sean, Brooke Wells has been known, as you said, to bust on some workouts that go longer. On that last pig flip, she had some trouble, and it looks like she's the one that's holding up the U.S. at this point. If anything goes wrong for them, it might be Brooke, so keep your eyes on that lane.
Now the United States is falling out of sync on those bar muscle-ups. Remember, they just have to be locked up out at the same time. And Brooke Wells, even though she was late, is going to fail. So that rep will not count. That could open the door for the Pacific team. They are just one rep back of the United States. And Europe is starting to creep up as well. The United States is done. On to the rower and the bikes. Rich Froning on the rower for the men.
Pacific
Smith on the bike.
Pacific right there with him at the exact same time. And on the pig flips, Pacific's women looked a lot more comfortable on the round of three than the United States did, especially with Brooke Wells, and she's on the bike on the left side. I don't know if that's the implement I would have thrown her on if she's getting tired. It's much more demanding on the body than it is on the rower.
The assault bike, if you've ever been on it, you know how awful that thing is, and Brooke Wells looks like she's feeling the effect right now. The United States trying to hold off the Pacific team. If the U.S. wins this event, the Pacific team finishes second, they will have the same amount of points in the standings. And now Canada has just wrapped up their third set of pig flips. They are well behind here and in danger of receiving no points once again.
Everybody's got one pig flip remaining. If I'm Rich right now, I'm yelling for these girls to push the pace because they're going to take a little bit longer than they will for the guys. And if Brooke Wells is having that much trouble, they don't have the time to get ahead of the Pacific since they're almost matched up rep for rep.
Every American team member is done except for Brooke Wells. The two Pacific women, Tia Toomey and Carl Webb, still working away on their calories. And Europe is done as well. So Europe and the United States will get to the pig at the exact same time. Pacific is done. Two pig flips for each pair remain, and it's going to be a mad dash to the finish line.
The U.S. needs to take advantage of this. They have to get ahead of Europe if Europe is going to beat the Pacific.
And Europe will win the event. The United States will finish in second, and the Pacific team is going to finish in third as they are well ahead of Canada. Great push at the end late there for the European team, as the United States will have to settle for second place as they faded towards the finish, and the Pacific team will take third. A great battle late in that event. Hey. Lukas Högberg, the only Swede on the European team. The other three are from Iceland. And the Pacific team has finished up, and those two women are going to get themselves a well-deserved break.
That's going to vault the European team up into a first-place position with those 6 points. Just 1 point behind the Pacific coming into this event.
And the Canadians are the only team left on the floor after they get through all these calories on the rowers and the bikes. They will have two pig flips for each pair, and then they will close out the event. So right now, about pride for Canada in front of their hometown fans.
Tell you what, though, if I were the guys, I wouldn't be going that hard. You already got 0 points. You can still finish, but you don't need to push that hard because you have two lifts that are imperative for you guys to stay in the hunt.
We're used to seeing Canada struggle late in the Invitational. As we said at the top of the show, the last 2 years, they have been in contention to win the Invitational. In 2014, they were in the lead going into the final event. All they had to do was not finish last, and they wound up finishing last. That gave the win to the Americans, and then last year, they had a chance to win it if they could beat the Americans in the final event. But once again, the United States took the victory, and now Canada is going to have to put on a hellacious charge over these final three events in order to get themselves into contention to win the Invitational for the first time. So the men are done with their two, and now they get to rest, and they will wait on Caroline Riesentivo and Michelle LaPagre. Once again, 360 pounds on that pig. Michelle LaTondra to close things out for Canada. Not the result Canada wanted, but a great ovation from their fans here in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada. As the Canadians get blanked on the scoreboard once again, but a great battle is developing for the top spot. And it was the United States and the Pacific that got out to that great start, but we're not used to seeing a Rich Froning team do this. They faded late.
They faded late, but Brooke faded late. She faded on those muscle-ups real bad and then slow off the bike. Pacific pushed the pace in the middle to get up tied with the United States, but nobody saw the European team coming on the right side. We were saying they were just going to try to beat the Pacific because the U.S. was so far ahead, but made quick work of those flips and just edged out the United States.
Neck and neck on those final pig flips, but Bjørgvin Gudmundsson, Lukas Högberg, Catherine David's daughter, and Sarah Sigmund's daughter getting across the finish line just ahead of the Americans to earn 6 points and the event win. Europe by just more than 2 seconds over the United States. Pacific at 8:36, and then Canada at 11:04.36 seconds. And Rory McKernan is standing by with Samantha Briggs and Catherine David's daughter.
We'll get to this event in just a moment, but we didn't get a chance to celebrate your event number two yet. Tell me, you've been dancing around that 200 pounds for a while. Was that a PR?
That was a huge PR. I love, like, my favorite thing in the world is snatching in competition, like snatching with the adrenaline and the energy. So my competition PR is always way higher. And I've once snatched 192 in competition.
So you have to thank these guys.
Thank you guys.
All right, Coach, this event came down to the finish. What was the strategy going into it?
Just to try and be smooth as possible and save energy for the pig flips and then go crazy on the last round, which I think they did.
It's a tight race from here on out. What needs to happen for Europe to take home the win?
Just to carry on as we have been. The guys stay calm, lift well, and then everything in the final.
Great job. Congratulations.
Because of that effort, the Europe team now has the lead by 3 points over the Pacific. The United States, the second place finish gives them 9 points, and Canada with just 2 points. Europe getting the win, and then in CrossFit style, staying to cheer on the Canadians. The men are up next in the Max Snatch and the Max Clean and Jerk. Back at the Tribute Community Center in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada for the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. We move on to event 5 of 7, and it's the Europe team currently holding a 3-point lead over the Pacific team. The United States is in third, followed by Canada with 2 points. We saw it earlier with the women. Now it's the men's turn. 1 rep max snatch and a 1 rep max clean and jerk. The team score, the sum of the max snatch plus the max clean and jerk. The lifters for the snatch, the record is held by Rich Froning, who did that in 2014 in San Jose, 305 pounds, but it's going to be Ben Smith who will be on the snatch for the men. Rich will be on the clean and jerk.
And you're probably asking, why do that? Why not put the best snatch up front? Because Ben Smith is pretty darn good at this too, but even more so, Rich is far and away better at the other athletes doing clean and jerk today.
Norman Carl Gudmundsson, Brent Fikowski, and Rob Forte, the other men on the floor, and it's going to be Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson kicking things off for the Europe team as they come in with the lead. 3 points to the winner of this event, 2 for 2nd, 1 for 3rd, and none for 4th, and no problem for Bjorgvin Carl Gudmundsson. Now remember, there's a 30-second window for them to lift. So if they hit one, doesn't mean they can't make another attempt, and that's exactly what Bjorkman's doing.
So 245 into 255. Take it back 2 years. He opened with 261, missed every single attempt. So he's being much more conservative this year.
Brent Fikowski at 275 pounds. And that'll count, a huge opener for Brent Fikowski.
That's going to be great for Canada, but also for the United States, because Canada has two guys that are pretty darn good at lifting, where the Pacific is going to have a little bit of issue with these lifts relative to the other three teams.
Rob Forte up next for the Pacific team here in round number one. Two attempts, so two 30-second windows for each team. This is the first for Rob Forte at 255. No problem for Rob Forte. Chad McKay asking him if he wants to make another attempt at a heavier weight. And Forte is going to do it. And that will count for Rob Forte at 260 pounds. And now Ben Smith to close things out for the United States at 255 pounds.
Now, we saw him do this in practice a couple days ago, and he actually had some trouble with this. The question mark was Ben's back after the first event. Looked good on the pig flips. Usually, when Ben's 100%, we kind of just kick our feet back and say, well, we'll just watch the United States win this event. So this is great, not only for Ben that he looks great, phenomenal list, back to old Ben Smith, but he's also going last. So he has the option to watch every single athlete go one more time through to see what he needs to put on the bar.
1 minute reset before we start round two. Bjorkman, Carl Gudmundsson kick things off. No problem there for Gudmundsson. And then 275 for Brent Fikowski. That was a little bit of a shock.
Well, Fikowski actually has a one rep list of 290. So someone who had a huge strength deficiency, not in this particular lift.
And Rob Forte hit his first attempt, added some weight, and then made the second attempt. And then Ben Smith, talk about pressure, made that one look easy as he hit 262 pounds. But it's Canada with the lead, and Ben Smith now will sit and watch. And he will lift last in round two. Bjorkman Carl Gudmundsson for the Europeans, the team that currently leads in the overall standings at 265 pounds. That one is good for Gudmundsson. Still plenty of time. He has added some weight. He'll make one more attempt. And Bjorkman Gudmundsson will hit that lift at 275 pounds, tying in with Brent Fikowski, who's trying to get this crowd behind him at 285.
Wow.
And Fikowski is picture perfect. And he's going to go for even more.
That should be 280 or 290 on the bar, which is his previous PR, and I think Gudmundsson put two and a halves on. So Goodmanson's number should actually be 270, just looking what he has on the bar right now. So I think it's 270 for Europe. So 5 pounds behind Canada now. Fikowski with 285. Now this is big for the Pacific. Now for Rob, he has to be a little bit more patient on the pull. You got to get as tall as you can, pull it as high as you can. The problem is it feels so heavy off the floor, you get a little timid at the top.
Chad McCann on the right. The Pacific coach was letting Rob know how much time he had, so Forte is going to have to settle for 270. Now Ben Smith at 277 pounds. And that is no problem for Ben Smith.
Through 10, Son, so that'll be 287. That'll put him 2 pounds ahead. 10 total pounds.
Smith can't hit that, but the United States still in very good position here as Ben Smith will turn things over to Rich Froning. In the United States now just 8 pounds behind Canada. The good news though for the Americans is that they're ahead of the Pacific and the Europe team. the two teams that they are chasing in the overall standings. Grover Carl-Gubinson kicked things off extremely well there in round number two.
That's exactly what the United States needed, sitting in that third place position. And nice to see Canada finally step up and challenge these other teams on the board. And who other than Brent Fikowski putting up 285?
And tried again and then got it to his thighs and said, that's not going to happen. Rob Forte missed his two lifts that he attempted in round number two, but Forte and the Pacific team still in good shape. One lift to go. And then Ben Smith, boy, no questions about the back after that.
I'll tell you what, that's a sigh of relief if you're a fan of the United States, how easy that looked.
Heading into the clean and jerk, it's the Canada team with the lead, 285 pounds. United States in second, Europe 2 pounds behind them, and then the Pacific team at 260. And now Rich Froning, who can lock up an event win for the Americans. 3 points are on the line. He will be joined by Patrick Vellner for Canada, James Newberry for the Pacific team, and Lucas Hogberg for the Europeans. And Rich Froning is a man who can put up some huge numbers. His personal best is 380 pounds. Now, Lucas Hogberg will be on the floor for the Europeans, and the Americans need to make up ground on both the Europeans and the Pacific team.
What's good for Lucas is that he's been in this position before. 2 years ago in 2014, he was doing clean and jerk for the European, where he put up 345 that time.
For the Pacific team and James Newberry, it's now about damage control, as they are only 3 points out of first place. Two events remain after this. 3 points go to the winner of this event. 3 points go to the winner of the handstand walk that's coming up next. And then 8 points go to the winner of the seventh and final event. So if Newberry can keep Pacific close, they have a chance going into the final event. Canada desperately needs a win, so the pressure is on that man, Patrick Vellner, who finished third at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games in his rookie year. Canada will be up first, meaning the Europeans will be the last team to lift.
A major advantage for the European team, who's holding on to that first place position.
And Patrick Vellner and Brent Fikowski trying to fire up the crowd. Canada comes in with the lead thanks to Brent Fikowski's 285-pound lift. No problem for Patrick Vellner. 335 pounds, so 620 total now for Canada. James Newberry from the Pacific team is up next. .315 on the bar for Newberry. Great lift for James Newberry. Oh. And that will count. The judge said he had it stabilized at the top long enough for the rep to count. So Newberry.
The problem for James is that he's in a 28-pound hole already coming into this, and he definitely doesn't have the highest clean and jerk as everybody else.
Rich Froning. No problem for Rich Froning. 355 pounds, and now the United States is in the lead. Lucas Hogberg, the final man to go in round number one. 340 pounds on the bar for Hogberg.
Now this is what he maxed out at in 2014.
That'll count for Lucas Hogberg as Europe moves into third place ahead of the Pacific team. Round one is over. Brent Fikowski on the left, Patrick Vellner, the man who's on the floor lifting, discussing some strategy before we start round number two, and Vellner will be up first.
Now, when you can't, there's not enough
in the tank to try to topple the United States. But what you need to do is to get ahead of the other two teams. Vellner hitting 335 in his opening lift. I tell you what, you talk about crowd helping you out like Katrin was talking about PRing. How about lifting in front of your hometown crowd in the middle of this competition?
James Newberry, who made his first appearance at the CrossFit Games this year, has looked solid so far. Great lift for him, although he struggled there at the end of it. You know what you're going to get out of this guy.
Now, the most riches put up in competition was the Games in 2015 when they had clean and jerk for the teams, where he put up 365.
Froning has the best lift for the clean and jerk so far, and the Americans currently lead. Patrick Vellner. Up first in round number two is Canada needs points. And Patrick Vellner giving this crowd something to cheer about as he hits that lift. 355, good for Patrick Vellner. Canada in the lead by 10 pounds now. James Newberry up next for the Pacific team. And James Newberry puts the Pacific team in front.
Now here's the deal. He has to hit this lift if they're going to win it. They're only down by eight.
And Froning, no problem. And when the pressure is on, Rich Froning comes through 365 pounds. Canada and the United States are tied right now. There is a tiebreaker. We'll get to that in a second. Lucas Holzberg now for Europe as the Pacific team is going to lock up another event win. The tiebreak goes to the team that has the lowest combined body weight between Canada and the United States. That's the United States. So U.S. will leapfrog Canada in this event because of that tiebreak. Those are the combined weights, and that's why the United States will finish ahead of Canada in this event. But Patrick Vellner, what a great effort from him.
We were wondering when Canada was going to show up to the event other than the crowd, and they did on the list when Vellner put up a monstrous 355 to put themselves up ahead of the United States. And that's tough to do going first, but Pacific, who's had a tough run these last three events, look unstoppable in events one and two. Just not enough strength on that team to put themselves in the contention during this event. And Rich Froning had to hit this lift to tie it up. And whose shoulders would you rather rest that on than a man who knows nothing but winning competitions?
Then finally, Lucas Holzberg was trying to get Europe ahead of the Pacific team. But the lift would not go. And James Newberry and Rob Forte, with a total of 674 pounds, take the event. Froning trying to keep the Americans in contention. He and Ben Smith will attack the handstand walk when we return.
Thank you.
Two events remain in the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational from the Tribute Community Center in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada. The Europe team, a three-point lead over the United States. The U.S. won that last event. We had to sort out some scores, but it was the United States that won. They earned 3 points. They beat Canada. Europe finished third, and the Pacific team did finish in fourth place. Event number six, like we saw with the women, is the handstand walk relay. One athlete walks the length of the floor, tags the second athlete, and then he walks the length of the floor to close out the event. Ben Smith finished seventh in that 280-foot handstand walk that we had at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games. But Canada, a good pair there as well. There is Ben Smith, who won the 2015 Reebok CrossFit Games, finished second this year to Matt Fraser. And some questions about his back, and one thing that he did say aggravates it is handstand walking. But it's Rich Froning who will lead things off for the United States. And this guy has no problem moving quickly on his hands. Event six is underway. 3 points for the winner, 2 points for second place, 1 point for third, and none for fourth.
Another huge opportunity for the United States to pick up 3 more points. On paper, they're the best team in handstand walks, but Newberry, just above Smith, is trying to pull the Pacific back out of this hole they've been in for the last few events.
The Pacific team comes in with a 3-point lead over the United States. Ben Smith is on the right, James Newberry's on the left. Ben Smith needs to get over that red line before he'll tag Rich Froning. Newberry's done, and he'll tag Rob Forte. Forte out first. Now here comes Rich Froning. And Rich Froning, we have seen this before. Think back a few years in the Cincos in the 2013 Reebok CrossFit Games when he chased down Ben Smith, but Rob Forte is not going to give up that lead easily. And now Patrick Vellner on the bottom of your screen starting to creep up on Froning. So Forte looking to win another event for the Pacific team. He looks like he's going to hold off Rich Froning. Vellner could help the United States if they finish ahead of Europe. It's going to be close. Vellner and Hogberg across the finish line at the same time, and Canada is going to finish third. So the United States will remain in contention for a win. The Pacific team is going to move up and close the points gap. And from the start, how about James Newberry?
Well, you take two guys from the games that, on paper, coming into this event, were the two worst handstand walkers from the CrossFit Games. Neither one of them came down, sprinted through both ends. I knew you and I were probably both thinking, it's like, well, Ben kept it close. Rich is going to be perfectly fine. But when they pass it off on the second round, I could not believe how fast Rob Forte was just pulling away from Rich Froning.
This was the handoff at the top of your screen. Is James Newberry, who tagged Rob Forte. And like Chase said, we've seen Rich Froning close bigger gaps than that. But give credit to Rob Forte, who holds off Rich Froning, and then Patrick Vellner, impressive work.
Vellner did USA another solid by getting ahead and staying ahead of the European team. And I tell you what, Pacific stepped up. They needed that so bad coming into the final event. They were just bleeding points on the leaderboard to the United States and Europe. But Pacific 1, USA 2, and Canada sneaking in just ahead of Europe.
The Pacific team, another event win as they beat the United States by 2 seconds in a close finish between Canada and Europe as Canada earns 1 point for third place as they edge out the Europeans. Rory McKernan is with James Newberry and Rob Forte.
James, let's talk first about the lifting. You looked very pleased with that clean and jerk. How close was that to what you expected to hit?
That was actually a fair bit more than I expected. I PR'd like 4 days ago when I got here off the plane, and then that was a PR too by 2 pounds.
Well done. And then Rob being chased, yeah, there you go. Being chased down by Rich Froning on your hands, you held him off. You look like you were sprinting. Is that, I haven't seen that out of you before.
I do like handstand walks normally. I knew it was a sprint, but I didn't know where we were. Couldn't hear the announcers over the crowd. which was awesome. I just trying to keep my hands there and keep sprinting and hope for the best. And when I crossed the line, looked up, and we came first, I was stoked.
Okay, you guys, coming up to the end here in great position. What's the plan for the rest of the event?
To execute the reps exactly like we talked about in training. We've got one to go. We've got to work as a team on the slug, and that's what we're hoping to do.
All right, your coach is breathing down my neck. I know you guys need to go prepare. Thank you, and we'll see you after the final event.
Thank you.
Thanks, Roe. James Newbery and Rob Forte moving their team into position for a win here at the Invitational as they and the United States are tied for second place. The Europeans remain on top by 1 point, and it was Canada doing the United States a favor. But James Newbery and Rob Forte continue a great Invitational for the Pacific team. One event remains. We are in for an exciting finish of the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. Just 1 point separating Europe, the Pacific team, and the United States. Canada has been mathematically eliminated. Pacific team has never finished higher than third at the Invitational in this current format. They are poised to win the whole thing, and Rory McKernan is with Coach Chad McKay.
Chad, it's all come down to the final in this Invitational. What do you tell your team going into this final event?
Go out there and execute. I said to them just then, they won the deadlift event, but they made a couple of small little errors, but those errors were fixed really easily. I was like, if there's a problem with the slug or the worm, fix it, move on, and just worry about executing.
All right. Third place is the best that the Aussies have finished in this event. What would it mean to bring home a win?
It would mean the world to these guys. These guys have worked hard all week. They worked hard back home. It'll mean the absolute world.
All right, thanks, Coach. Good luck.
Thank you.
Back to you, Sean.
Thank you, Ro. Chad McKay and the Pacific team getting ready for the seventh and final event. And to put the CrossFit Games season into perspective in the Invitational, this is basically our all-star event. But we start with the Open in March, 5 weeks, five workouts, more than 324,000 people competed, but only 660 advanced to stage two. That's the regionals, 17 regions. We combine those into eight regional competitions. 660 individuals compete, only 80 advance to the final stage, stage three, the CrossFit Games. 80 athletes, 15 events, one man and one woman are crowned the fittest individuals on Earth. And then finally, the Invitational, our all-star event, 14 to 16 athletes, and we crown one team the Invitational champion. Sean Woodland and Chase Ingram here at the Tribute Community Center in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada. It wasn't that long ago when the CrossFit Games season wasn't year-round like it is now.
No, you could sign up for the CrossFit Games, actually. I don't think people realize that. It used to be kind of a backyard barbecue throwdown in Aromas, California, back-to-back years until they start to advance. And now from signing up to the CrossFit Games to just having to train your butt off all year, that's where the sport has gone and evolved to.
We have one event to go here at this Invitational. What has impressed you so far?
I would say the composure of all teams sitting up there in the top three. Now, Europe, I feel like, has been the most consistent across the board, but USA took a big shot in the first couple of rounds, brought it back. Pacific rolled hard, lost some step, brought it back. We couldn't ask for anything better going into this final event.
One final event remains, and it's pretty much winner take all. We will crown the champion of the Invitational. Event number seven is up next.
It all comes down to the seventh and final event here at the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational, and three teams can bring home the victory. Europe, Pacific, and the United States all still in contention. The Europeans have been extremely consistent, but the United States, after that rough start that saw them finish fourth in event number two, they have come on, and now they are putting on the pressure on the Pacific and the European team.
It's amazing how consistent Europe has been, just based off how their practices look, the blow that the United States took to come back in, and then how Pacific has been pushing everybody the whole time. And to come this close, 15-14-14, I swear we're not writing this stuff. Just to have this type of finale is fantastic.
There's a lot going on in this final event. You have coached teams. You have been part of events like this. If you're coaching these teams getting ready for this final event, what are you telling them?
Take a page of the Aaron Rodgers playbook. R-E-L-A-X, relax, okay? Do what you're supposed to do, and you will be successful. The problem is people start trying, especially in a team event full of individuals, I'm going to win it for my team. You can't do that. Not with a worm, especially on both sides. You got to stick to your game plan. Don't get ahead of yourself in the beginning, and then be consistent and push hard towards the end.
We talked earlier in the week about the Europe team, how they haven't quite lived up to the hype that they've always brought into this event. So far, it looks like they're doing that. What's the key for them here in this final event?
They had some trouble with the worm at the end during practice. The worm was slipping over their shoulders. You know, you got to stay steady. What they've done all day is slowly beat people at the end of the events, almost a page out of the United States playbook. Don't get ahead of yourselves. Don't let the moment be bigger than you as an individual. Work for your team and stay consistent.
The seventh and final event, there's a lot going on here. We'll take you through what awaits these athletes in event number seven. As mixed gender pairs, they all need to complete three rope climbs. Then each athlete needs to complete 30 strict handstand push-ups while his or her partner holds a handstand. Then they come together as a team, and it is slug cleans, 30 pig jump overs, and 30 pig thrusters. Rory McKernan is on the competition floor with more on the final event of the Invitational.
The inspiration for these implements like the slug and the worm that you see at the games comes from Dave Castro's background in special operations. And in that environment, it's literally to make teams disjointed until leadership emerges. So here's what I'm thinking is that Rich Froning has experience in the teams. We've seen him in the Invitational with strong leadership. Even in practice, the European team did not look good with this implement. It's all going to come down when we get to the heavy slug. Who can emerge as a leader?
Europe comes in with a one-point lead over the Pacific and the United States. That really doesn't matter. Just keep in mind that whatever team finishes first here wins the Invitational. Canada is the only exception. They have mathematically been eliminated. Rich Froning and Brooke Wells trying to lead the United States to their third straight Invitational championship.
Now, if you're Europe or Pacific, looking left to right at the United States, you're looking at Brooke Wells. How is she going to handle these three rope climbs?
You're watching the scoring hat at the top of your screen. They will receive one rep every time one of their athletes completes three rope climbs, and that is Brooke Wells, who we have seen struggle on rope climbs in the past.
Now, if I'm Rich, I'm going to slow down a little bit. You don't need to go fast. You can't win this event here. But if you go too fast and you blow up, that was very smart. That's what I want to see from a team captain. I'll go back to back, give you a little bit more rest before that last rope climb. That is very smart on Rich Froning's part.
So far, the Pacific team is the first team with all of their athletes onto the handstand push-ups. Once again, if you're watching the scoring hat, every time one of their athletes completes 30 handstand push-ups, they will receive one rep. So eight total reps before they move on to that 225-pound slug. Every team onto the handstand push-ups. The Pacific team was there first, followed by the United States. Europe got there as well, and Canada. 8 points to the winner of this event, 5 to second place, 2 for third, and none for fourth. Rich Froning up in that handstand hold as he and Brooke Wells are partnered up. Kerry Pierce and Ben Smith have partnered up. Once Brooke completes her 30 strict handstand push-ups, Rich Froning will switch places with her. Europe has one athlete done. with 30 handstand push-ups, as does the United States.
Now, Brooke Wells is starting to fall apart. Upper top left part of your screen. She's had a break over six times. Now, they haven't lost too much ground on Pacific because Tia Tarakumi had some trouble on the handstand push-ups as well.
The Europe team has two athletes done, so both of their pairs have flipped. Remember, eight, that's the magic number. Eight reps on the top of your screen. That's the magic number before they can move on to the 225-pound slug. Catherine Davis' daughter with one to go. She can't work until Bjorven Gudmundsen, her partner, is holding a handstand. So Gudmundsen kicks up, and now Davis' daughter can complete her final rep, and she and Gudmundsen are through. Europe taking the lead here, and now all four European athletes are onto the slug,
in which we've seen before in practice they had some trouble. Now they're going with this little touch and go. They practiced this a little bit yesterday. This is a long event towards the end. 30 reps is a lot, and you can get a little out of hand.
The Canada team has moved in to second place. Remember, they are mathematically eliminated. The Pacific team is struggling on the left of your screen to finish up their 30 handstand push-ups as Carl Webb is the last athlete working for them.
Europe is just a little bit out of control, out of sync, trying to go too fast. The worm is not a fast movement, period. You can't go faster than another team and expect to beat them. Here's what Rich does the best. He slows them down because every rep you don't miss is a rep you gain on the team ahead of you. So look for the United States to move up and challenge both Canada and Europe, not here, but even more so on the second half of this event.
Canada is done with their first set of 10. They'll walk that thing forward every 10 reps. We will count all these reps as one on the top of your screen. So 38 is the magic number before they move on to the pig jump overs. That worm needs to move from the ground to the shoulder, back to the ground on the other side in order for the rep to count. Europe is through 25 of the 98 total reps on the scoreboard.
Now, what I like to see from Europe is I feel like they finally got the rhythm. They went a little too fast, dropped the worm about three or four times. No issues there in the middle set of 10.
Europe is in the light blue. They're your leaders in the yellow lane. Canada are in the red tops. They got to that worm second, and now a no rep for Europe. And here comes the Pacific team catching up with the United States. Whoever finishes ahead out of the United States, the Pacific team, or Europe will win the Invitational.
Now, United States thought they were done in the blue lane, had to do one more repetition. And I said methodical was the way, but not slow. You can't go slow with only 30 repetitions. If this were 50, maybe 100, this is the pace you need to go. But the U.S. needs to speed it up just a little bit, or Europe is going to just be too far ahead for them to catch them at the end.
The United States trying to put the pressure on Europe. They have won three of four invitationals, and both in this current four-team format. Now the Pacific team is advancing. They are closing the gap between themselves and the United States. Europe is done with their 30 slug cleans and now 30 synchronized pig jump overs. They have to clear that thing. They can't stop on top of it.
Of the teams that looked the best with the worm, it was the Pacific yesterday. Just nice rhythm, even height across the board. Good call out.
Canada sits in second. They just got hit with a no rep. They're now trying to sort things out with their judge as Europe is now through 51 and counting of the 98 total reps. And the United States, Rich Froning, slowing them down, trying to make sure everybody is in sync here as Europe has put quite a bit of distance between themselves, the United States, and the Pacific team.
I'd be worried if I was the United States. Europe looking pretty strong. They definitely have the athletes that they need for these N30 thrusters. They're not going to make up too much time on these jump overs, especially with the time they're taking in between. Look at Pacific. You can't really see him over on left side lane one. Look at their cycle time between reps between them and the United States.
Europe with a no rep, and now they are done as they make that wrap up. So 30 pig thrusters. That pig now weighs, 30 slug thrusters. That thing weighs 300 pounds, so heavier than the last implement that they faced like this. They have to squat below parallel and move it up and over their heads for the reps to count. So Europe, with just 27 reps between themselves and their first ever invitational victory. The United States is trying to hold out the Pacific team. They're trying to finish second overall. And now they are having trouble on those pig jump overs as Team Canada has moved up, just fighting for pride right now. They've been mathematically eliminated. But Europe continues to put distance between themselves and the U.S. and Pacific teams.
And a 10-rep lead is going to be hard to make up with only 20 remaining for the European team. And I was looking at Ben Smith, and he just seems totally gassed at this point.
The United States is on the left of your screen. They are in the blue, in the middle, in the light blue. That is Europe. They have never won the Invitational. That could change as they are now just 17 reps away. 98 is the magic number. Jorven Gumitsen in front. Behind him is Sarah Sigma's daughter, Catherine Davis' daughter behind her, and then Lucas Hogberg in the rear. Now 10 to go for the Europeans, and barring a collapse, it looks like they will win the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. Canada has moved up into second place in this event, but it doesn't matter for them. As Europe now, with five to go, Bjørven Gudmundsson, Sarah Sigmund's daughter, Catherine David's daughter, and Lucas Hogberg getting hit with a no rep. They are done, and believe the hype! Europe has won the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational! States is in. They will finish third. And now Pacific is in, and that will conclude the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. And this is not what we expected.
Now, on paper, we thought they looked good, but just saw past performances. Honestly, when I was writing everything down, trying to see who would do what, I didn't even have Europe in the conversation as far as how they looked coming in and what they've done in the past. But I'll tell you what, Europe, slow clap and stand of applause for you. What a performance, consistent all day. That was incredible to watch.
And for that woman, Michelle Atondra, this is an emotional goodbye for her. She is retiring from competition, and what a way for her to go out than in front of her hometown fans here, her home country fans here, in the CrossFit Invitational. A great career for Michelle Atondra, six times at the CrossFit Games. She's been at the Invitational before, closing out here in Canada. So Rich Froning and company will come up short as the European team wins the Invitational. 23 points for Europe. The United States, 4 points back of them as they can't overcome that slow start. The Pacific team started great, but faded towards the back half of the competition, and Canada comes in fourth place. Final results for the last event here. Europe by 3 seconds over Canada. The United States comes in just a tenth of a second ahead of the Pacific team.
That was just incredible to watch. I thought they might have had gone out too fast on the clean and jerks first part of the slug. They dropped it a few times, a little out of control, but they reeled it in, found the rhythm in that second set, and they never looked back once they got to the final 10 of the clean and jerks.
The 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational is in the books. And it's Europe with a victory march to the finish line. We will have the trophy presentation to the 2016 Invitational champions when we return. The 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational on ESPN is brought to you by Arasti, the official athlete care provider for the CrossFit Invitational. Arasti, we fix pain fast. For the first time, the Europeans win the CrossFit Invitational. The United States, they had won the last 2 and 3 of 4 overall. They finished in second place. Pacific had a great start, but they wind up in third in Canada with a disappointing fourth place finish. But in the final event, we talked at the top of the show, Brooke Wells had some concerns when it comes to bodyweight gymnastics movements, and there it was.
Yeah, especially the high skill. We thought the rope would be a problem. Rich did a great job intertwining two to give her a break, but it turned out that the handstand push-ups really brought them back a lot, but they still weren't out of it at this point. Personally, I think they were just too conservative on the pace for these clean and jerks in the middle. And then Europe, I thought they came out a little too fast. They had about 3 or 4 no reps in the first 30. A little no rep even there at the end, but you know what? They never batted an eye. They kept pushing hard. They stayed in just enough control to give themselves the win.
Check, 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 check. Your 2016 Reebok CrossFit Invitational Champions, Team Europe!
You're trying to turn these things into weapons. We got to coach you up on that next time for your celebration. But this one's been a long time coming. BK, on the last workout, you took the lead. What was motivating you through that last workout?
My mother's birthday.
Mom's birthday today.
Yeah, my mother's birthday today. This is for Iceland, and this is for Europe. Congratulations, Europe!
All right, so you guys, it seems like we need to invite Lucas to live in Iceland now at this point as well. Sarah, the workout that had the bikes and the rower, it looked like you were a zombie afterwards. How'd you manage to recover for the rest of the event?
Got some carbs in my system.
You just needed to eat.
I just needed to eat, yeah.
All right, Katrin, fittest woman on earth, 2 times in a row. How does this compare with the CrossFit Games and competing as an individual?
It's totally different. It's a different competition. It's now you kind of got to gauge and be on a team and get to share this experience with all of them. It's so great.
All right, Lucas, obviously the entire thing was a very difficult road, but what stands out, what event or what moment stands out for you for the entire event?
So the pig flip, yeah, for sure. And I also tried to keep up with these awesome Icelandic people. Shit, they're crazy.
All right, well, you guys are the champions. Congratulations, ladies and gentlemen, Team Europe.
Team Europe, for the first time, wins the CrossFit Invitational. And Chase, you said it earlier, consistency. And it's always been the name of the game in CrossFit competitions. They proved it here.
As with individuals and with teams. But I tell you what, this is so great to see. This is going to be the best thing we could see for the sport in the Invitational. I'm already looking forward to 2017. Congratulations, Europe.
And with that, we close out the 2016 Reebok CrossFit Games season. Michelle Atondra with an emotional goodbye to her home country fans. The Pacific team put on a great show. Rich Froning and the Americans, impressive as well.
Done!
It was the Europe team winning for the first time as they live up to the hype. For Chase Ingram and Roy McKernan, I'm Sean Woodland. Thanks for joining us. The Open is right around the corner, and we will see you in 2017.
beer. You can't drink beer.
All right, guys, let's get this started. Welcome back. This is the Cool Down Show. And first of all, I just want to start with this hometown crowd giving some love to the home team. How about it? He's here for Canada. Got the Latondra sign. Coach, you've been a fittest woman on earth. You've been involved with this event a few times. How proud are you of these guys?
I'm super proud. They never give up. There's some little thing that happened, and they finished super strong. So we had a couple PR.
Yeah.
Pat, 10 pound on his clean and jerk. Caro got 2 on our clean and jerk. And Michelle and Brent were like 5 pounds away for their max. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, pass the mic down to Mr. Fikowski. Put on quite a show there on the snatch, my friend, even though at that point mathematically it looked like you guys weren't in contention. Tell me about that. Was that for the crowd? Was that for pride?
I like snatch, so I was hoping to give Pat something of a lead to maybe catch the Team USA. Wasn't quite enough, but it was a lot of fun, and it's good to have the crowd behind me.
And then Pat, how did this stack up with your experience at the games this year? How's it different?
This is fun. This is just a different kind of pressure and a different sort of environment, right? So it's a whole different thing to work on a team and to be able to lean on each other, like Brent said.
Uh-oh. And people knew who Pat was now, so that was kind of fun.
Yeah, he's not wrong.
Big deal.
They have a big romance together.
All right, how about for you, young lady, your rookie season was 2011, and you've said that this is going to be your retirement year. Can you tell us why you made that decision? It's got to be a little emotional for you.
It definitely is. I was really lucky to compete my last time in front of my home crowd. So, yeah. Yeah, it means a lot. But the reason is simply because I want to move on to other things. I love CrossFit very much. I want it to be a big part of my life, but I don't want competing to be a big part of my life anymore.
Yeah.
I want to coach. I want to live a normal life, more balanced, training once a day and moving on. And I'm really appreciating that.
Yeah. I saw that you had a moment with your boyfriend after the event. What did you tell him?
I told him I can't wait to have a glass of wine tonight.
There's a ton of champagne
on the
floor.
And that I loved
there.
Him. I love him too. I told him I love him. Yeah.
Mr. Castro, you get to plan these. I know a lot of thought goes into it. How do you like the way that this year's Invitational played out?
I was really happy with this event because of the end and how close it was. All three teams had a chance to win it. And in past years, there's been scenarios where teams have run away with it. but the level of competition in the field, all of these athletes are so good now. We were just talking about this, and one mistake and you're completely out of it. And so it was balanced competition. The best team prevailed, and I was happy with each workout by itself and all of them as a total, as a whole.
All right, Kara, Webb, you guys started so strong. You look fantastic, and it came down to the final event. Tell me about how that one played out.
It played out exactly how we expected. You know, we're Aussies, and the thing we do best is we work hard, but we have fun while we're doing it. And we came together. We were super united. We had a good spirit, and we put in absolutely everything that we had into every workout from the start to the finish. We might not have all the tricks in the book, but we work really, really hard, and I'm super proud of how we pulled it together.
Let me, would you mind passing over to the 13 champ there, Sam Briggs? Sam, tell me about this team coming together. I know it's probably, you got to be chomping at the bit, wanting to get out on the field, but how was it in your role as a coach leading these guys to victory?
I think unlike the other teams, we didn't get a chance to train before, so we tried to make the 2 days that we had as beneficial as possible. Had a little bit of team bonding. Katrin showed us all her true colors.
No, that sounded bad, Sam. You gotta like clear that out.
And then they
no way.
They pulled it out of the bag tonight. I couldn't have asked anything more from them. They gave everything and came out on top.
All right, Dave, we asked social media for some questions, and pretty much most of their questions were directed at your announcement, but I know that you have more than one. Are you ready to release any of those?
Let's hear from some other members of the winning team.
We just talked to Team Europe.
Just talked to one person from Team Europe. I want to hear from the other members.
Okay. We heard from these guys right after the competition. Let's hear from Chad McKay. Chad, you've been a coach a number of times. You've been an athlete in this event as well. But yeah, let's talk to Chad. So watching in that final event, how difficult was that to not be out there and help them with that slug?
Look, it was one of those moments where I was just super proud for the team. The last event, they were a little bit behind on the handstands, and then they finished really strong on the slug and the worm, and it all comes down to that teamwork communication at the end. So super proud of their efforts.
Well, actually, let's do this. Show of hands for who PR'd today on any of their lifts. Once, yeah, it counts. The warm-up counts. That's outstanding. Katrin, we asked you earlier about yours, but what happened on that? You said you've never even lifted a bar heavier than 190, right?
Yeah, so I've actually never even attempted a snatch or even pulled more than 190. So I know that I can always do so much more in competition. I just know that about myself. I love competing. So I knew that if I could open up strong and just go for that 200, I needed the competition to do that. So it was the perfect scenario.
All right. Real quick. I want to hear from the four-time champ, Mr. Froning. You've been involved in this event since the very beginning. How have you enjoyed watching this thing grow and move around?
It's been great. You know, appreciate the crowd here. Everybody's supporting everybody. It's been awesome. Thanks, Canada. But just the evolution of all the events, and like Dave said, you know, the first couple of years it was a little bit of a wash one way, but this year, one mistake in any event could, you could drop one to three places. So it's been cool to see.
Mr. Smith, if you could go back and change one thing, what would you change from this event in particular?
Probably would have taken out the first event because it was really hard. But no, other than that, it was a great event. Everybody was really competitive. The field's getting stacked now. So, like Rich said, one mistake and you're out of it a little bit. So, you know, thank you guys for supporting all of us, and congrats to all the athletes.
All right, guys, I want to take a moment to actually thank all the staff and volunteers who made this possible, because they were great. And all of you fans, you guys were amazing. Thanks for coming out and giving these guys so much push and energy to do what they do. Without you guys, they wouldn't stay motivated. We wouldn't stay motivated to put on a great show. So give yourselves a round of applause. I am really excited about this first announcement. It's something that's been developing for a few years, and in 2017, we plan on introducing a new division to the Reebok CrossFit Games. The 35 to 39-year-old division. There's a lot of athletes that we're excited to compete and watch try to qualify for the games. And we're gonna have legends of our sport from years past now have another opportunity to compete against each other sooner than the 40-year-old division. So that division is personally something that I'm really excited about. And I think all of the fans and the community, they'll also appreciate that additional Masters division. Now, with this additional division, we are also taking the games to a new location, as a lot of you know. It started with a search. A lot of cities applied or put in a request to entertain us to host the games. We whittled it down to a few who were the most serious, and we did some tours and visited different facilities. We saw a lot of great cities, a lot of great towns, a lot of enthusiasm for hosting us. But in the end, after 3 years at the ranch and then making the move to Carson, which at the time came with a lot of doubt and a lot of disappointment. People were not excited that we were leaving the ranch. We're leaving Carson, and I feel people might be disappointed or not be excited about the move because it's changed, and that's understandable. But I'd like to ask that everyone trust us. After a few site visits, we know we're gonna be able to put on an amazing show, an amazing event, amazing test, an amazing community event in the city of Madison, Wisconsin.
The CrossFit Games have called two places home, Aromas and Carson. In 2017, a new city is added to the list, Madison, Wisconsin. The capital of the Badger State is the perfect place to test the fittest athletes on earth. The city plays home to more than 200 miles of trails and 23,000 acres of water, as well as a world-class venue. The Alliant Energy Center will host the main events. For the fans, the entertainment options are as diverse as the terrain. From farm-to-table dining to a booming microbrew scene, Madison will be a home for the growing affiliate communities in the Midwest. The next generation of the CrossFit Games starts right now. Be part of the fittest crowd on earth in Madison.
All right, what do you guys think? All right, one more time, please give it up for the athletes who competed today. Yeah, please give it up for you guys, the crowd who made it happen. We'll see you soon when the Open comes around in January. Look for registration. Until then, guys, we'll see you soon.